Hello, I'm Paul. This video is the second part of a two-part piano tutorial on Chopin's Ballade No. 1. This, the practical part of the piano, is divided into 10 practice sections, and we look at the ballade together, step by step, in detail, mixing at tempo with slow tempo practice suggestions. This tutorial features my hand-notated practice score, which, if you think it might be useful to you, can be downloaded free as a PDF from a link in the video information. The ballade is a very difficult work to play, and it seems the better you get at piano, the harder it gets. That said, you might find it helpful to put all of that out of mind so you won't feel intimidated by it and discouraged from taking it on. So, let's begin. Chopin's original manuscript is in America's Library of Congress. In preparation for printing, you can see the publisher penciled a D over the E-flat written in ink in Chopin's hand. And here I removed the pencil in Photoshop. Some early publications understood the E-flat, some changed it to a D or suggested it as an alternative. It's worth playing and counting bars 1 to 7 with a metronome set to around 50 BPM to get a sense of the rhythmic variety, what is music, and what is rest.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Crescendo from the bottom to the top of this mildly dissonant spread chord in bar 7 and strike the B flat at the top with just enough force to create the resonance necessary to connect with the entry of theme 1. In bar 8, Chopin introduces theme 1. Some say this was Chopin newly arrived in Vienna, where the ballad was written, expressing his loneliness and homesickness for Poland at war with Russia. in the first measure of theme one, the suggested fingering, is 1, 2, 3, and the fifth finger slides from B flat to A. The fourth on G changes to 2 with the note down. The fingering works well, but there's another I prefer which I'll show you. Notice how the thumb slides to hold 2 adjacent notes, enabling the B flat and the A to be played with fingers 4 and 5, giving a little more control over the touch of these notes. We have both singing voice and accompaniment in the right hand. The crotchets, with the tails down, are marked staccato. The pedal indications on the score are perhaps incomplete, so we have to use our best judgment as to the use of pedal, especially in this section. The sustained melody and detached chordal accompaniment have complementary characters throughout theme one. The aim is to find the right amount of detachedness, so needs a light touch for the melody to sing. The figure of theme one repeats 7 times. Figures 1 to 4 can connect in a dynamic arc. 5 to 7 together crescendo and lead us forward. Vary the dynamics and rubato as the figures repeat. Figure 1, gentle crescendo and decrescendo. Figure 2, moderate crescendo and decrescendo. Figure 3, strong crescendo and quietest decrescendo end. Figure 4, moderate crescendo and a pronounced writ at the end of the decrescendo with a breath. The momentum starts again with figure 5, moderate crescendo and decrescendo. Figure 6, strong crescendo and less decrescendo. Figure 7, powerful crescendo and moderate decrescendo as the mood changes. In this edition, the left-hand fingering in bar 22 and 23 suggests changing the 1 to a 5 on the minim at the top of the octave, but turning the wrist and passing the second finger over seems to work too. The melody is now at the top of the chord, so needs voicing independently. Here's this short cadenza again slowly to show how the notes in both hands fit together. And when it's played quickly, if you wish, it can have an expressive writ to round off the ending. Thank you. Theme 1 continues from bars 44 to 67. The two note slurs in the left hand have a yearning quality, so bring out the top note, then release to the lower, and practice left hand alone. In the heat of the moment, be careful not to drown out the right hand with the left hand accented chords. The arpeggios gradually release the tension. Left hand follows the right. Towards the end, we can sing out the left hand melody, so to allow these notes to breathe, switch over and fit the right hand to the left. In section 3, we have the first entry of theme 2, and the key changes to E flat major. The section as a whole can be thought of as subdivided into three episodes, each progressively more impulsive. If theme 1 expressed Chopin's homesickness for Poland, perhaps theme 2 expressed his affection for Maria Wodzinski. He had proposed marriage around the time of writing this ballad. As the music picks up momentum, Echoes of theme one in a major key mingle with middle voices, occasionally accented, in a long rising and falling phrase. As the momentum increases further, we are led back, almost imperceptibly, from the lyrical key of E-flat major to G minor. In section 4, theme 1 reappears, recoloured with mystery, and the anticipation is heightened by the rhythmical repetition of E in the bass. This transition appears twice in the ballad. Tension created on this occasion is released into a joyous re-entry of theme 2. In section 5, we have the grandiose re-entry of theme 2. The key changes to A major. Although marked fortissimo, we still need to vary the dynamics to get a sense of rise and fall in each phrase, rather than play one dynamic throughout. As both hands have lots of chords and octaves to connect smoothly together, we need to make doubly sure our wrists and arms are free from tension. In the first entry of theme 2, the left hand arpeggio pattern was in single notes, and here we have something similar in the accompaniment but as chord inversions. Avoid any unnecessary hand movement, especially with the octaves later in the right hand. Notice the occasional pivot notes along the way, which help support the moving wrist, connect chords and octaves. This section, or any similar section marked fortissimo, does not have to be practiced fortissimo. Mezzo forte is kinder on the ears and the piano. Slow practice with your preferred octave fingering. Here's a suggestion. To find the fingering most natural to your hand in passages such as this, group notes into pairs and practice as intervals. This helps your hand find the best position to be covering the keys in anticipation of playing. If you find you sometimes lose your way climbing up in this little cadenza, just think about the bottom note as a scale and let the top note play itself subconsciously. Accenting the bottom scale in practice might help your muscle memory and make sure the wrist and forearm is relaxed and follows the fingers. In section 6, we have the entry of a waltz, which could be thought of as theme 3. Some say this describes Chopin's impression of life around him as a composer-pianist in the salons of Vienna. The left hand has a rhythmic diminished octave dissonance which needs to come through. In section 7, we have the third restatement of theme 2 in E-flat major. The first entry was intimate, the second joyous, and this entry has a passionate intensity. The return to theme 2 and the key of E-flat establishes a sense of symmetry to the ballad's design. Thank you. This section has the feel of an improvisation, and if you have trouble fitting the right hand with the left, that's to say fitting three notes against two, just accent the left hand meter as in the following example and it quickly sorts itself out. You can feel the meter change at this point. In section 8 we have a transition to the coda. It's similar to section 4 and is a restatement of theme 1. As previously, this transition has an atmosphere of anticipation and becomes increasingly anguished, reaching a climax of expressive intensity and plunges into the coda. Coda, the time signature changes from 6-4 to 4-4. The new meter reinforces the effect of pace suddenly quickening. Also, the accented chords in the right hand fall unusually on the weaker beat of the 4-4 meter. One, two. Thank you. Section 10 is a powerful conclusion to the ballad with a scalic cadence in G melodic minor, creating a sense of resolution and finality to the work. We began dramatically in A flat major and end dramatically in G minor. If you practice the chromatic scale with fingers 3, 4, 5 regularly, it strengthens and improves coordination of these weaker fingers, especially useful in octave scales such as this. I hope you found this tutorial useful, and a reminder, the hand-notated practice score seen throughout the video can be downloaded free from a link in the video information. Dividing and subdividing piano works into practice sections is an approach some find helpful in learning and the memorization of large-scale piano works such as this. The long-term aim being to unify all the sections as one later, when the time is right for you. I hope you enjoy practicing the ballad and encourage you to take it at your own speed and, above all, interpret it in your own way. Thanks for watching.